My name is Alex.
And I'm Connor.
And this
Connor.
Is Connor.
Connor.
And we are Perception Squared. Thank you guys for joining us today. All right. So we're going to be taking a look at some of the techniques and creative approach that we used in our film, My Brother's Keeper, today.
So first off, we're going to start with a bit of technical background on the project before going into story and scene breakdown. We shot this film in 3D 360 on the Jaunt 1 and a custom camera rig that we built ourselves that shoots 180-degree stereo front and 180-degree monoscopic back. And the film premiered with Jaunt and HTC at Sundance 2017. And so far, we've gotten some great feedback, as well as some nice reviews from TechCrunch, Engadget, and Time Magazine. It was really important to us to get very close and intimate with our actors on this film. To do that, we basically developed a close-up camera system that we were going to use that was made out of backbone-modded GoPros and an Atenya 220 lenses. This started with a Lego prototype, which is pretty fun. We spent like 2 hours in the Lego store.
Best tax write-off ever.
Yeah.
The Lego store receipt, highlight of career.
Modding GoPros and Legos together to kind of figure out the configuration. After we figured that out, we tested a couple different rigs at Radiant, but ultimately landed on the backbone rig that we built. And we that system basically allows us to get as close as 1 foot to our actors and keep accurate stereo depth. And we dubbed that rig the Johnny 4, which is named after the Johnny 5 robot from Short Circuit, because it looks kind of like him, and it has 4 lenses, so we did the 4. We also shot part of the film on the Jaunt 1 at 60 and 120 frames per second, and we worked directly with Jaunt to unlock a beta firmware that would allow us to shoot at 120 and play back at 30 frames per second. So we were really able to get some cool cinematic slow motion for our battle scenes.
So My Brother's Keeper is a story about two estranged brothers that find themselves on the opposite sides of the Civil War, and they meet on the battlefield of Antietam. So before we go into the specifics of the creative approach, we want to just start by watching sort of the climactic scene of the film. This is the brothers meeting each other on the battlefield, and it has some flashbacks to their childhood as well.
Everything we were, everything we could have been, this war twisted it away. If we never meet again, please forgive me.
All right. So that is the scene we're going to be kind of delving into, looking into some more of the some more of the technical and creative approach behind. Now that everybody's thoroughly sad. And you're right.
So now we're going to talk a little bit about the story and some of our creative choices in the film and how they were used in the scene that we just showed you. So I'm sure all of you guys know that narrative in 360 is extremely challenging. There's a lot of inherent problems to it. It's really difficult to keep your audience focused because there's no clear front to the sphere. So users tend to get lost or miss important story elements. Trying to use sound or picture to direct your viewers can often lead to clunky storytelling that lacks subtlety. You know, using arrows or loud noises, you know, saying, hey, look over here, isn't something that we do in traditional cinema, and we shouldn't do it in cinematic VR either. And then it also has a lot of technical challenges on set with monitoring, camera motion, playback, directing, lighting. To find solutions to these challenges, we started experimenting with a lot of different techniques from traditional cinema and applying them in VR. And here are a few of the techniques that we used in the film.
So close-ups are arguably one of the most important tools that filmmakers have. Traditionally, they've been the way that we really peer into a character's soul, see their motivation, see the subtlety of their performance. It's a very important part of the traditional filmmaking tool belt, if you will. A lot of people think that close-ups can't really exist in VR the way they do in traditional cinema, but using 180-degree camera systems, we can actually get really good stereo depth as close as about a foot. Using that kind of a VR close-up, for lack of a better term, is actually really similar to the sort of intimate wide-angle shots that you see from cinematographer Emmanuel Lubitsky. He uses that kind of technique on most of his films, you know, Birdman, Tree of Life, The Revenant. It's very much his styles, get really close to characters and really intimate like that. So this is we're going to show you a clip of an example of how powerful that kind of proximity can be for capturing performance.
You're doing this because you're scared to death, like the rest of us, that you don't matter. And you know what? You're right. You don't. It's not important, okay? You're not important. Get used to it.
So as you guys can see, there's a lot of different layers of subtlety and complexity to that performance. There's like five different beats that are happening all in that performance. So now, take something like that and move it, you know, 6-7 feet away from the camera. It loses a lot of its power. It kind of gets lost in the haze of resolution out there. And that's something we really want to try to avoid. So a lot of filmmakers, because of that limitation, they end up taking this very large theatrical approach to performance in VR. And a lot of times it creates this kind of clunky soap opera effect where you've got performances that would really not be like acceptable in a traditional film being put out because, you know, they have to try to get this performance across this sort of 7-foot gap. On My Brother's Keeper, throughout the film, but specifically at the end, we really wanted to try to have subtle performances and try to get as, you know, get as grounded as we could with these. And so we tried to get the camera as close to our actors as possible so that you can really perceive all that and see all those moments of subtlety and not have to overact to sort of get to the camera, if you will.
Now we're going to talk a little bit about eye trace and how we used it in the film. And first, I'm going to show you an example from Mad Max Fury Road.
He turned his head, he looked me straight in the eye! He was scanning the horizon! No! I am awaited! I am awaited in Valhalla!
Come on!
So I was pointing at the screen just to kind of make it really apparently obvious how every single shot in that scene is directly center of the frame. George Miller center framed the entire film to kind of allow him to cut quickly and not lose or overwhelm his audience. In the BTS of Mad Max, he was quoted as saying, "Always put the crosshair on their nose," which was referring to the intense precision that he wanted with his center framing. This is kind of a simplistic but effective example of eye trace in cinema, and usually it gets a lot more complex. Eye trace is something that is a valuable tool in traditional cinema, but it's incredibly important in VR cinema. If your viewers aren't looking at what you want them to look at, they're not going to see it at all. So we use eye trace to focus the viewer and keep them looking where we want them to look. We use it to move the story forward and make sure our audience doesn't get lost searching for the story within the sphere or miss key story elements. So match cuts are another thing we experimented with at the end of the film in the climax scene. This is kind of a stylistic technique used in film, and it's something that can be translated to VR. Basically, if your characters don't move between cuts, you can cut very quickly without it feeling jarring or disorienting. It's kind of similar to the cutting in Mad Max, but to like a more precise degree. So we are like actually lining up like characters' eyes. We found that match cuts work really well in VR and allow for some interesting stylistic choices.
So now we're going to take a look at the way we use camera's perspective, sort of in a unique way in this final scene. So I'm going to start by playing this clip real quick, which we've already watched, but this kind of give you an idea of the specific shot we're talking about.
Everything we were. Everything we could have been. This war twisted it away. If we never meet again, please forgive me.
We also, in that scene, tried to get as close as possible to the performances, close to the actors, and really get intimate. Like, we pretty much pushed everything we could to the limit. The camera's on the ground, to the side, a couple of feet away from the actors.
I think it was, probably a foot and a half away from their faces.
This is definitely pushing the cameras to their limits, but the idea was to try to just create that sense of intimacy and that sense of vulnerability to the scene that we felt was really important. Another technique we utilized a lot in My Brother's Keeper is camera motion. Camera motion's really valuable in traditional cinema. Similar to iTrace, even more valuable in VR. There's a lot of things we can do with camera motion in VR that are super helpful. One of them is focusing an audience. So if you're moving in a direction, there's a very natural sort of deep-seated human desire to just sort of look in that direction, especially in VR. So if you want somebody to look this way and you don't want them to get distracted over here, if the camera's pushing this way, there's a pretty good chance they're going to look that direction. So that allows us to control focus without pointing people or telling them where to look. It also adds a lot of additional depth through the parallax effect, especially for 2D 360. Like, sometimes you can see really well-executed camera motion. It almost feels like you're watching 3D when it is actually monoscopic. The other purpose, just like with traditional cinema, is to create dramatic tension. You know, you have a scene where you're just sitting in a room and you're watching someone give a performance. It's a very different experience, and if you're slowly pushing in on them, there's a sort of language of cinema that we know if you push in on somebody, it means something, and there's some importance to what they're saying. And we can leverage that in VR as well. So this final scene, we also used, we experimented with a new technique we had never really used before, which was a selective 180-degree blur to defocus a portion of the frame and create kind of a tunnel vision effect. So when we were first doing our sort of scene breakdown and shot blocking for this final scene, we walked through it a bunch of times and we kind of realized it didn't work super well in 360. We had to cut across space in this battlefield, and we felt that if you were right in that character's face and you were, for some reason, want to turn around, you'd see the other brother across the battlefield as this tiny little speck. And then when you're looking back there, we might cut back here, and now you're looking across the battlefield the other way and there's a tiny little speck. And it just didn't really seem like it would flow very well. So we tried to figure out a way that we could control the audience a little bit more to make that scene work. And what we came up with is a selective blur. So by using this blur, we're kind of able to guide perspective and tell people this is where you should be looking without necessarily having to use a sound cue or like point them in that direction. We just say, you can look here, but it's out of focus. Sort of similar to the way like on a long lens, bokeh is kind of guiding you towards the part of the frame that's in focus. It allows you to really focus on like a macro area of a frame. So we executed this using Metal's blur tool for Premiere, which was awesome because we didn't have to leave Premiere. We could stay in Premiere and refine, and we did a lot of rotation and stuff the same way. We didn't have to leave Premiere to do a lot of our refining and figure out how this would work. We could just apply it, play it back, and then say, okay, that's cool, and then not have to do a full round trip to After Effects. We love slow motion. We love slow motion a lot. For all of our traditional films and work we've ever done, we use slow motion a ton, and we were really excited to be able to use it in VR. And this was a project that we really felt it would be a good fit for because the battle scenes, it kind of has this sort of floating, sort of elegant style to it. Slow motion lets us bring this really surreal, kind of dreamlike quality to VR productions, this sort of cinematic feel that's a lot of times missing, and do some really interesting things. It really lets you kind of just take in everything around you as it's moving so much slower. You have time to really appreciate all these moments that are happening. It can be a really powerful technique in VR.
So now we're going to kind of share some of our thoughts on how we think we can work together to craft more compelling stories in virtual reality. If you want to make art in VR, you have to let the story lead the technology. Art is a human form of language. It's how we communicate emotions and ideas that are too complex to express with just words. In order for this to happen, we need artists to lead technology and not the other way around. Don't make rules for yourself. This is definitely the time for experimentation. Find all the rules that everyone has already set up about VR, try to break them to tell better stories, because it's the only way we'll learn what works and what doesn't work. Mm-hmm. And focus on your story first, not your technology. Good storytelling starts with the script. Write a meaningful story, and then figure out a way to make that story work with the tech that exists. Technology changes every day. Good stories last forever. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you guys for joining us today.
Yay. Woo.